Well, Dr. Madison, first and foremost, let's talk about the news today. Johnson & Johnson releasing their vaccine. What does that mean for the vaccination effort?
Oh, my goodness. It's such a game changer for us that are out on the front lines providing this vaccination. You know, there's so many amazing things about this vaccine. In addition to the fact that it's only one dose, the fact that the storage requirements are much less restrictive. So for somebody who's been having to kind of deal with all of those, you know, logistical and operational hiccups, you know, making sure that things are stored at the appropriate temperature, vaccine is being utilized in the amount of time that it's needed to be, all of those things kind of go away with the Johnson & Johnson product. So it's definitely welcome news for those of us that are trying to get vaccines to the most vulnerable in our populations and those who lack access to vaccination.
A lot's been made about the efficacy rate not being as high as Pfizer or Moderna's. Is that something people should be concerned about?
Absolutely not. All three of our vaccines that currently have EUA status or the emergency use authorization by the FDA, they are all, the number one thing is that you will not be hospitalized and die from COVID-19. And so I think some people are getting very fixated on that efficacy number, but what people should remember is that the two previous vaccines that we already had authorized were not tested in our current real world situation. So remember, the Johnson & Johnson vaccine has been tested in the presence of these variants and the mutations that we know that we're facing right now. The CDC director just came out today and said, you know, a dire warning that, you know, our only and best hope is to get as many people vaccinated as possible before these variants take over.
And what's your role with Roseman University? You oversee the vaccination program for Roseman?
Yes, so I've been working directly with the state as well as with the Southern Nevada Health District. So we have collaborated as one of their community partners, have been able to be designated as a location to store the vaccine as well as to be an administration site. And then we also go out during the week and help the Southern Nevada Health District with their strike teams to go out into the community. So we're actually going to be going back to Doolittle Community Center, which is in the heart of a predominantly African-American neighborhood in the historic, you know, West Side neighborhood, and we'll be going back to do second dose appointments for those individuals that we were able to vaccinate earlier last month. So I'm very excited to be able to help that patient population as a woman of color and as a healthcare professional and as a public health and vaccine advocate. It gives me such joy to be able to provide that vaccine confidence because people see someone who looks and sounds like them and can give them honest information about the vaccination and why it's so important for them to get vaccinated and everyone else in their community.
And we've done quite a bit of reporting on how the vaccination rate inside communities of color, not as high as white communities. Is that a resistance? Is that an organizational issue? What are the factors at play there?
So there's multiple things at play there. So obviously vaccine hesitancy does play a role, but I do think that because some of the areas where we did have those storage requirement needs, right? So the ultra cold storage for Pfizer and then the freezer temperature for Moderna limited where we could do those community outreaches. So previously we've been able to partner with faith leaders, community centers, and I think it took us a little bit more time to be able to do some of those things at some of those community centers. So like I said, we're about to go back and do second dose appointments for the Doolittle Community Center. But again, it took us a little bit of time to be able to do the logistics and the planning to be able to store the vaccine at an appropriate temperature and still be able to provide vaccines for that area. And so part of it is access in addition to the hesitancy, and then also just getting the word out about how to make an appointment. So there are some people who may not have access to online resources in order to make the appointment. So we are, you know, really encouraging family members, friends, you know, younger, more tech savvy individuals to adopt a senior, right? Adopt a senior, help them through the process, help them make sure that they can get that vaccine appointment, and then do what you can to help them actually get to that appointment as well, because we do know that people also have transportation issues as well. So, you know, make sure that even if it's not your time to get vaccinated, that you help that elderly person or that vulnerable person in your life to make sure that they're vaccinated and protected.
And how do you break down some of that hesitancy?
Yeah, I think a couple of things. So number one is obviously we do need to make sure that we are being very honest about the fact that there are individuals in the African-American community that feel hesitant against anything that the government is specifically giving out, right? You know, we've got historical, issues with experimentation on that population. We've got examples of treatment being withheld or being substandard. So we do need to address that, and we do need to make sure that people understand and know that the vaccinations are safe and effective, and not to mention the fact that the Moderna vaccine, the lead scientist on that project was an African-American woman. So, you know, those kinds of facts, I think, really help people when they're trying to make the decision or if they're on the fence about whether or not they think that they should be vaccinated, as well as the fact that I'm there and I talk about my own personal vaccine experience, and I talk the talk and I walk the walk. So I tell people, you know, I've been fully immunized, and I am very honest about my own personal vaccine journey and how I and why I decided to get vaccinated, not just for myself, but for my community.
Are you hoping some of those older members who got the shot will serve as ambassadors to the more hesitant members of the community?
Absolutely. We need those, you know, those beacons of hope and wisdom in the community to come out and talk about their vaccine experience and talk about why, you know, that's such an important thing. I think when people talk about their why, it's so much more impactful than just talking about what they did, right? So why did you get vaccinated? And, you know, I ask people this question and they tell me, you know, I want to be vaccinated because I want to be able to see my grandkids. I got vaccinated because I want to be able to, you know, visit with my friends again. You know, I got vaccinated because I want to know that when I go to my community center, that I'm not going to be a danger to those around me. So understanding that why and making people understand the personal aspect around getting vaccination, that it's not just about their own personal health, but it really is about the health of our community as a whole. And the quicker we can get everyone vaccinated, the faster we're going to be able to end this pandemic.
When the vaccinations first started, we were flooded with rants, but we have noticed that it's really kind of slowed to a very small trickle of people complaining, and it seems like people are finding it easier to get a vaccine. Is there a certain learning curve that perhaps vaccine organizers and administrators have kind of conquered over the last couple of weeks and things are running smoothly?
Absolutely. I will tell you, we have a task force that meets every week at Roseman, and we do a debrief and we basically do a postmortem and we talk about what things went well and what things didn't. And we continue to evolve and do constant quality assurance every time we have a vaccine event at our university. And I do think that not only that, but learning from the strike teams that I do with the health department during the week has really helped us to continue to improve and to provide the best quality service we can to individuals in the community. One thing I will say is that when we transitioned to doing our senior population, there were some adjustments that we needed to make in order to really help access for those individuals. So, you know, one of the best examples I can think of is helping people make that second dose appointment on the same day that they're getting that first dose. Initially, that was a little bit more challenging because our vaccine supply was a little bit more tenuous. But now that we have vaccine on hand and I can guarantee that I can give those individuals that second dose, I feel much more comfortable making those second dose appointments for people on the same day that they get their first dose.
Well, Dr. Madison, thank you so much for updating us on the progress, and we'd like to circle back with you now as we get through this vaccination period.
Absolutely. And again, I'm so excited to have this new J&J vaccine. I just got an email from the health department asking me how many doses I wanted. So I can't wait to get started and to really be able to ramp up this vaccine distribution even more than we already have.
All right. Well, thank you again for your time.